Hello, good afternoon. My name is Chris Johnson. I'm the Freeman Chair in China Studies here at CSIS. Thank you all for coming. Despite the snow, we weren't sure we were going to make it today, but fortunately the road crews seem to have largely done their work. Today's session will be looking at the Third Plenum primarily, and we are very blessed here to have with us one of the authors of the Third Plenum document that has gotten so much attention in both Chinese domestic and Western and other foreign media since the plenum in November. And we are very honored to be hosting Mr. Zheng Xinli. He is permanent vice chairman of the China Center for International Economic Exchanges and former vice minister of the Central Policy Research Office of the Central Committee of the Chinese Communist Party, which is really the party's official think tank. So we're very lucky to have Mr. Zheng with us here today. Born in April 1945, Mr. Zheng earned his master's degree in economics. He's a senior research fellow focusing on macroeconomic theory and policy. He attended a number of plenary sessions of the Central Committees of the Chinese Communist Party of China and participated in drafting, as I just mentioned, the report of the work of government, the 8th five-year program, the 9th five-year plan, the 10th five-year program, and the 11th five-year program. So certainly someone with tremendous experience walking through China's economic reform challenges. He's been long dedicated to research and study of economic theory and policy, and he's done profound macroeconomic control and medium to long-term development policy inside the system, in which he generates unique insights as well. His work and papers, which add up to over a million Chinese characters, are included in volumes 1, 2, and 3 of Zheng Xinli Economic Anthology in China, Industrialization in the 21st Century. From 1978 to 1981, he was studying at the Graduate School of the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences and graduated with a master's degree, as I mentioned, in economics from the Industrial Economics Program. From 1981 to 1987, he served as the division chief level researcher and then deputy team leader at the Research Center of the Secretariat of the Central Committee of the CCP. From 1987 to 1990, he acted as the deputy chief economist of the State Information Center under the National Development and Reform Commission. And from 1999 to 2000, he worked at the State Planning Commission as the Deputy Director General and then Director General of the Policy Research Office and Deputy Secretary General and Spokesman. From 2000 to 2009, he was the Vice Minister, as I mentioned, of the Policy Research Office of the Central Committee, Adjunct Professor and Doctoral Advisor for Renda of China, Central University of Finance and Economics, and the Graduate School of the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences. So again, what a distinguished individual that we're pleased to host here with us today. The format will be Mr. Zheng will come up and deliver his formal remarks. We're going to do consecutive translation, so we'll be pausing to have the interpreter catch up. And then we'll do some questions and answers with the audience. As always, we will follow standard CSIS procedure. If you have a question, please raise your hand and identify yourself and do ask a question rather than a monologue. Without that, with no further ado, we'll have Mr. Zheng come up and deliver his speech. Please.
Ladies
and gentlemen, good afternoon.
In 2019, during the Chinese Spring Festival,
At this time of the year, which is the transition between the season of winter and the season of spring, I am very honored to be here with my colleagues, to be in Washington and to meet my counterparts in CSIS to introduce the very important decision on comprehensively deepening reform that has been adopted in the third plenary session of the 18th CPC Central Committee.
去年11月，中国共产党召开的18届三中全会所做出的决定，对未来7年中国的经济体制、政治体制、文化体制、社会体制、生态文明体制和党的建设制度的改革做出了全面的部署。这个决定 影响着未来中国的走向。
In November 2013, the third plenary session adopted decision of the Central Committee concerning the major issues on comprehensively deepening reform, which laid out a overall very comprehensive blueprint for China's reforms in the economic, political, cultural, social, ecological, and party building dimensions in the next 7 years, and it generates a tremendous impact on China's future trajectory.
决定涉及到的改革一共有300多项。那么今天呢，我想着重就经济方面的改革在这里做一个介绍，因为这个决定提出来经济体制的改革是整个改革的重点，它对各个方面的改革起到重要的牵引的作用。再加上我本人是长期研究经济问题的，啊，对这份比较熟悉一些。我想简单的把经济体制改革方面的4个重大的突破啊做一个介绍，然后把更多的时间呢留给大家一起来讨论。
Over 300 different reform measures have been put forward, but today I will focus on those relevant to the reform of the economic system for 2 reasons, because the reform of the economic system is the most important part in this decision. It serves as a driving force of the rest of the reform measures. And the second reason is that I personally have been devoted to economic issues for a long time. So today I will briefly introduce the 4 major breakthroughs in the reform of the economic system. And then I'll leave time for the Q&A session.
在经济体制上的第一个重大的突破，就是提出使市场在资源配置中起决定性作用。
The first major breakthrough is that the market will play a decisive role in the allocation of resources.
那么过去呢，我们是讲基础性作用，这一次把“基础”二字改为“决定”二字，它体现了中国共产党对市场经济的认识进一步深化。
In the past, we said that the market should play a basic role in the allocation of resources, but this time we changed the word basic into decisive, which is a proof that the Communist Party of China has deepened its understanding of the market economy.
从经济学上讲，市场决定资源配置，就是由市场主体按照价值规律独立自主地进行资源的配置。
And by letting the market play the decisive part, we're saying that the market players should independently make decisions to allocate resources and give full play to the role of the law of value.
通俗地说呢，就是由企业根据市场价格的信号，自主地决定上什么项目，生产什么产品，生产多少产品，政府不要干预。
And to put into more simpler words, it is that the enterprises should, based on the signals of market prices, decide on their own which project to undertake, which products to make, and how many products to make. And the government will play no part in the operations of these enterprises.
市场决定资源配置至少将发挥这样两个作用。第一，就是在各个部门之间，通过由市场决定资源配置，那么就可以实现按照社会的需求，在各个部门之间来分配社会劳动，从而实现各个部门供求的大体平衡。
At least 2 major impacts can be generated by this decision. The first is that a balance between supply and demand will be gradually reached among different sectors based on the market decisions on the allocation of resources and based on the distribution of labor according to market demand.
哪一个部门它的产品供不应求， 那么它的销售价格呢就会高于它的价值，那么干这个行业呢就赚钱，那么就会吸引社会资金投入到这个行业，从而这个行业就会增加供给，实现供求平衡。
When supply falls short of demand, the prices of this certain product will be more than it is what it is actually costs. So making these kind of products will rake up a lot of profits. So it will absorb a lot of social funds and it will increase the supply.
比如说金融这个行业，由于过去处于垄断地位，获得了垄断利润，所以它的资金利润率高于社会平均资金利润率。将来呢，我们吸引更多的社会资金进入，那么就会改变金融行业供不应求的局面，就会降低企业的融资成本。
For example, the financial sector in China has long been the monopoly sector. So there has been the profitability of this sector is much higher than that of the rest of the economic sectors. So by absorbing social funding in this sector, we will be able to alter the landscape where supply falls short of demand, and we will achieve a balance between these supply and demand.
有的行业它是供过于求，那么这个行业呢，它的产品的销售价格就会低于价值，那么干这个行业呢，利润都非常微薄，甚至不赚钱，那么资金就会从这个行业抽出来，投入到别的行业，比如说现在钢铁，在中国炼一吨钢，纯利润只有4毛6分钱，那么连一根冰棍都买不着，如果有市场决定资源配置，那资金早就抽出去，投入到金融行业了。但是由于行政分割、市场封锁，阻碍了生产要素在部门之间的自由流动。
And in some sectors, supply is much greater than demand, so the prices will not reflect the actual costs, and there is almost zero profit in such sectors. So by taking some of the funds out of these sectors and to put them in other sectors, we will be able to achieve balance between different sectors. For example, the steel industry. Actually, at present, the profitability of making steel is very, very low. It's about 4.6 cents. So it's not even enough to buy a popsicle. But if we let the market decide the allocation of resources, we will put the funds into the financial sector. However, this kind of movement now is blocked by administrative segmentation and market blockade. So we need to address this issue.
市场决定资源的第二个作用，就是在一个行业内部，通过市场的作用，把资源配置到那些最有发展前景的企业，那么落后的企业由于得不到资源、得不到资金，就会被淘汰啊，实现一个行业内部的企业的优胜劣汰。
And the second major impact is seen within a certain sector, which is that we will let the most competitive enterprises win by putting funds into those enterprises that have the most promising future, and those backward or those enterprises that lag behind will be taken out of the competition.
我们知道，资本主义在它诞生的100多年时间内创造的生产力超过了人类历史的总和，它的原因就在于有一个市场经济机制能够魔术般的把生产力呼唤出来。我们的改革也就是要创造这样一个能够魔术般的把生产力呼唤出来的经济社会机制。
As we all know, the capitalism has not emerged very, very a long time ago. It's been only a little more than 100 years. But in these over 100 years, it has created productive forces that are much higher than the aggregate of the production forces in the previous human history. And the reason that the capitalism can magically unleash the productive forces is that it has set up a market economy mechanism. And this is what we are trying to obtain. That is, through this new round of reform, we have to set up a market mechanism in both our economy and society.
市场决定资源配置绝不是改两个字，而是要建立一种机制。那么这样一种改革，它对中国的经济体制将会产生决定性的影响，而且对文化体制、社会体制、生态文明体制都将产生重要的影响。它是我们这一次改革中间的一个
So the change of from the word basic to the word decisive is not just semantic. We are trying to set up a market economy mechanism, and I think it will generate a decisive role to China's overall economic system. Also, it will have a major impact on China's cultural, social, and ecological systems. I think this is the most important breakthrough in this new round of reform.
决定在经济体制上的第二个大的突破，就是提出混合所有制是基本经济制度的重要实现形式。
The second major breakthrough is that a mixed economy should be the major approach to materialize our basic economic system.
这是中国共产党对基本经济制度认识的新的发展。
This is a new breakthrough in CPC's recognition of a basic economic system.
按照这样一个理念，我们将进行这样一些改革。第一，就是对国有企业的管理将由过去以管资产为主，转变为以管资本为主，将会成立若干个资本管理公司，对需要投资的行业和企业进行参股和控股。 并根据企业的股份的多少，拥有不同的表决权。
And now we have laid out some relevant reforms under this general principle. The first is that we will change our way of managing state-owned enterprises. Previously, we focused on managing assets, and now we will shift to managing capital. And by so doing, we will establish several capital management companies and to hold shares or control shares in the enterprises that are involved in some basic and strategic industries. And based on the amount of the shares, they will have the voting power.
第二，就是国有企业将会吸收民间资本入股，发展混合所有制。 现在混合所有制在整个经济的比重占到40%左右，将来比重会逐步提高，也可能再过10年到20年，混合所有制经济占整个经济的比重会上升到50%、60%，一直到70%。
And the second, major approach is that the state-owned enterprises will absorb private capital to invite private capital to hold shares in the SOEs. Now, private capital takes up around, now it takes up around 40% of the overall economic landscape. And in the next 10 to 20 years, we are hoping that the number can rise up to 70%.
混合所有制将成为企业的主要的产权组织形式，也就是说，一个企业可能既有国有股，又有集体股，又有个人股，又有外资股。And
a mixed ownership will be the basic form of the company's property rights system. That is to say, there will be both state-owned shares, collective shares, and individual shares in a company.
用生物学的观点来讲。 就可以发挥杂交优势，在更大的范围内来优化资源配置。
And in biological terms, we will give full play to the advantages of a hybrid system and to give each part the different ownerships its best role to play.
第三就是混合所有制的企业允许员工持股，特别是管理层持股。
And the third thing we're going to do is to let these mixed economy, is that the mixed economy will allow employee stock ownership plans.
这是吸收了国内外企业的成功的经验，包括美国的一些百年老店的企业的成功的经验。
This is a decision we've made after we looked into the successful experiences of both domestic and overseas enterprises, including some century-old companies in the United States.
包括像 IBM, 像GE, 像波音这样的公司, 那么它有骨干层持股，有核心层持股, 有老的员工的持股, 那么就给管理层戴上了一个金手铐。
Companies like IBM, GE, and Boeing have not only the stocks of these companies are held not only by those at the top, but also by the general employees. So the management rank of these companies have been somehow handcuffed in terms of their daily performances. And this is a very successful practice.
那么公有制经济和非公有制经济以及混合所有制经济在规则上平等，在使用资源上平等。Both
the not only the public ownership, non-public ownership, and the mixed economy will enjoy an equal access to opportunities and to rules and to resources.
第三个大的突破就是农村土地制度改革的重大突破。
The third major breakthrough is the breakthrough in the rural land management system.
允许农民承包的土地可以抵押担保转让。
We will allow farmers to take their income from mortgaging, guaranteeing, and transferring their contracting right of their land.
允许农民的宅基地和房产抵押。
The residential plots and the houses of these farmers are allowed to be mortgaged, to be guaranteed, and to be transferred.
允许农民的集体的经营性建设用地与国有土地同权同价。
The farmers, the collectively owned, profit-oriented land held by the farmers will have an equal access to the land market state-owned land. They will have the same rights and same prices.
那么这就意味着我们三中全会送给农民三个大红包。
This means that the third plenary session is giving three bonuses, three big bonuses to the farmers.
第一个红包价值几何？每年的转包费，从理论上讲，18亿亩耕地可以从转包中拿到1万亿元人民币。
So how big is this bonus? In China, there are 1.8 billion mu arable land, and for the subcontract fee of these 1.8 billion land, it is 1 trillion RMB every year.
第二个红包可以拿到51万亿元人民币，相当于我们现在银行全部的居民储蓄存款的总额。
And the second big bonus amounts to 51 trillion RMB. It is about the same. It's about the same amount of the total resident deposits in China's banks.
当然，这只是一个理论上的计算。那么，能不能拿到这些红包，那么要看他能不能把自己的这些土地进行抵押担保转让。
However, these bonuses are just calculated theoretically. Whether the farmers can get these bonuses will depend on whether their land can be mortgaged and can be transferred.
这将有效地缩小城乡居民收入的差距, 避免中国落入中等收入陷阱。
But anyway, it will effectively narrow the income gap between urban and rural residents and will steer China away from the mid-income trap.
第四个重大突破就是允许民间资本发起设立中小商业银行。
The fourth major breakthrough is that we allow private capital to set up small to medium-sized commercial banks.
同时要建立地方性的监管机构, 把这些小的金融机构的监管权交给地方政府。
Meanwhile, we will establish local oversight agencies and handle the oversight authorities to local agencies.
而且这些小的金融机构只能在本区内存款和贷款, 这是学习了美国的经验。
But these small to medium-sized commercial banks will be limited to loaning, to borrowing and loaning within the, a certain region, and this is an experience that we learned from the United States.
同时要建立存款保险和贷款担保制度，用市场机制来化解风险。
Also, we will establish the deposit insurance and loan guarantee system so as to diffuse risks through market mechanisms.
同时，要发展多层次的资本市场, 推动人民币资本项目可兑换和人民币的国际化。
Also, another focus of the financial reform is to develop a multi-layered capital market and promote the convertibility of RMB under capital account.
这四大改革将会激发出六大潜力。
Six major potentials will be unleashed by these four major breakthroughs.
第一是消费需求的潜力。
The first is a potential in consumption.
中国的居民消费率现在只有 34%, 美国是 70%, 中国的居民消费率提高 10个百分点呢，每年将会有 8万亿左右的消费，这么大的数量来拉动经济的增长。
As we speak, the consumption rate in China languishes at only 34%. The number in the United States is 70%. If we increase the proportion by 10% each year, there will be approximately 8 trillion RMB worth of consumption generated. So it will have a major impact on driving our economy.
第二个大的潜力就是 第三产业将会迅猛发展。现在中国第三产业从业人员占全社会从业人员的比例只有 36%， 美国是 80%。 如果我们把第三产业从业人员的比例提高到全世界发展中国家的平均水平 50%， 那么可以新增1亿1000万个就业岗位。
The second potential is in the tertiary industry. We will see a surge in the tertiary industry. At present, the number of people working in the tertiary industry take up only 36% of those compared to the total compared to the rest of the national economy, sectors of national economy, and the number in the United States is 80%. So if we raise this proportion to that of the average of developing countries, that is 50%, it will generate approximately a GDP worth 110 million RMB.
第三将会激发科技创新的巨大的潜力。我们申请国内申请的发明专利的数量已经连续三年超过美国，居世界第一位。我们申请的国际专利的数量，2010年跟美国比，美国是我们的6倍，2011年是我们的3.6倍。 2012年是我们的2.8倍。 也许再有3年左右的时间，中国申请国际专利的数量有可能赶上美国，这样可以通过技术创新来带动产业升级。
I'm sorry, I have to correct a mistake. It's not a GDP 110 million. It's 110 million new jobs being created. I'm sorry for that. Okay, the third potential is a technology innovation. For three consecutive years, China has ranked first in terms of the domestic patents application. In 2010, in terms of the international patent application, the United States is 6 times that of China. And in 2011, it's 3.6 times. In 2012, it's 2.8 times. So we're hoping that within 3 years, China will catch up with the United States in terms of our international patent application. Application. So this is a major progress in technology innovation.
第四，将会激发资本存量的巨大的潜力。现在我们银行的 M2 已经有120万亿，银行的金融资产达到160多万亿，外汇储备达到38000亿美元。
The fourth potential is in our capital stock. Right now, the M2 in China's banks is around 120 trillion RMB. The financial assets of Chinese banks are 160 trillion RMB, and our foreign currency reserve is around 3.8 trillion RMB. So we will generate a very great stimulus into the capital stock in China.
第五个潜力就是劳动力供给的潜力将会发挥出来。现在我们农业劳动力还有2亿6000万人，如果发展集约化的农业、现代化的农业，那么将会 今后10年到20年，将会有2亿农业劳动力转移到第二、三产业。Fifth,
there is a great potential in the provision of labor forces, which will be stimulated. At present, there are 260 million rural labor force in China. Through agricultural modernization over the next 10 to 20 years, 200 million rural labor force will be transferred to the secondary and tertiary industries.
美国一个农业劳动力可以种几千亩地到10000亩地，中国现在一个农民只能种6亩4分地，差距太大了。所以，中国农业要向美国学习，提高劳动生产率。
In the United States, an individual of the rural labor of a rural labor workforce works on several thousand mu up to 10,000 mu. However, in China, a farmer operates on only 6.4 mu land. This is a gigantic gap. So China needs to upgrade its agriculture and to raise the rural productivity.
第六个潜力也会激发出来，就是土地供给的潜力。我们现在的农村的宅基地占了17万平方公里。 那么通过城市化、通过集约化的利用，那么不仅可以满足城市建设用地的需要，而且还可以增加一部分耕地。The
sixth potential is in the provision of land. At present, there are 170,000 square kilometers of residential plots in China. Through the urbanization process and through a more intensive use of this land, these 170,000 square kilometers of land will not only meet the demand of urban construction land, but also the rural labor land for rural labor.
通过全面改革, 激发这六大潜力，足以支持到2030年之前中国经济的持续健康发展。
If we successfully stimulate the potential in the above mentioned six major sectors through this new round of reform, China's economic growth will be sustained in a healthy way up to 2030.
那么中国经济的发展为中美经济合作带来了新的机遇。
China's economic growth brings new economic opportunities for China-U.S. economic cooperation.
第一个机遇就是中国扩大消费，将会扩大对美国的消费品进口的需求，包括汽车，包括猪肉，包括饲料等等。
The first opportunity is an expanded demand for consumption for commodities. There will be a surge in our demand for imports from the United States, like in automobiles and pork and animal grains.
第二，中国产业升级将会带动对美国的技术装备和电子元器件的进口。
Secondly, China's upgraded industry will drive up imports of technology equipment and electronic devices from the United States.
现在中国一年进口的各种芯片就花了2000亿美元，那么将来进一步发展呢，进口量还会大幅度增加。
Now China spends $200 billion every year importing chips from the United States, and in the future, this number is expected to grow.
第三，会增加对美国的投资。现在中国的资本存量已经很多，那么随着外汇储备的增加，我们对外投资。 将会出现一个迅猛增长的阶段，那么对美国投资的增加将会为美国带来更多的就业的机会。
Thirdly, there will be more investment into the United States. Right now, China holds a lot of capital, and as our foreign currency reserve continues to grow, there will be a surge in outbound investment, and it means more jobs for the United States.
第四，我们第三产业的发展将会扩大对服务的进口，那么在这方面呢，正是美国的优势。 那么金融啊、保险呐、技术专利啊等等啊，那么中国将来进口的需要量会增加。我们在吸引外资中间，那么服务业的引进的规模也将会不断的扩大。
Fourthly, there will be a rise in our demand for the services, that is in the tertiary industry, and this is where the United States takes the lead. There will be a lot of demand for the import of finance, the financial services, like and the insurance and some technology patents. So, I think there will be a very different picture in terms of our attraction of foreign investment.
展望中美两国贸易投资合作的趋势，第一将会是。 中美之间有过去中国过度的依赖美国，向中美对等依赖的方向转变。Now,
looking at the future, looking into the future of China-U.S. trade, investment, and cooperative relationships, there will be a shift in our mutual. In the pattern of mutual reliance. In the past, China excessively relied on the United States, but in the future, we will rely on each other equally.
第二个趋势就是中美之间的投资将会由过去美国向中国投资这样一个单向的资本流动向中美之间资本的投资的双向流动的方向发展。
The second change is in the capital flow. In the past, the majority of the investment is from the United States to China. It is mostly one way. But in the future, there will be a two-way free flow of capital between these two countries.
第三个趋势就是中美产业的技术的分工将会由过去的垂直分工
The third is in the industrial and technological distribution. In the past, it is a vertical distribution, and in the future, it will be a horizontal one.
比如说，在高铁技术上，在通讯设备制造技术上，现在中国已经具备了向美国投资的能力。
I'll give you some examples, like in the high-speed rail sector and in the manufacturing of telecommunications equipment. Right now, China is equipped to invest in these areas in the United States.
昨天下午，我用了整整一个下午的时间，坐火车从纽约坐到华盛顿。
Yesterday afternoon, it took me almost a whole half day to take the train from New York to Washington, D.C.
中间我到洗手间去啊，从那个车厢里边走过，一晃一晃，差一点倒下来。
When I was approaching to the men's room from my seat, the train was moving left to right, so I almost fell on my knees.
如果采用中国的技术，用中国的投资，那么纽约到华盛顿的 火车的时间可以由4个小时缩小到1个小时，另外从车厢里来回走动，绝不会来回晃啊。So
if we adopt the Chinese high-speed rail technology, the time will be narrowed from previously 4 hours to 1 hour, and you will never fall when you walk in the compartment.
所以中美两个国家没有理由不合作，谢谢。
So there is no reason that China and the United States should not cooperate. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much for that very comprehensive presentation and an appropriate condemnation of our rail system here in China, in the United States. Okay, we're going to take questions from the audience now. As always, please do identify yourself and your affiliation and just for clarity, we'll be webcasting and recording this event, so please ask your question in English for our Chinese friends. Let's start here in the blue.
Hi, Chen Weihua, China Daily. Yeah, question, you talk about companies of different ownership will be able to play by the same rule, because SOE, they are always intertwined with the rulemaker, regulators. So you think it's possible to make it fair for private company and the SOEs? The other is you talk about steel industry, which is a very low profit. You said a popsicle, but I don't think that profit is even there if you count the environmental cost. How this happened? How are you going to solve this? Because are you going to solve this problem by market forces, they said, or just administration orders? Thank you.
他问了两个问题，一个是关于您说到这个所有制，不同所有制经济都要在同样的规则下运行，但是这个国有企业与这个政策和规则的制定者总是有一些密不可分的关系，所以这样的情况下对私人企业对民营资本他们是否真的公平呢？第二个是关于您刚才说到的这个钢铁产业，其实您说到这个利润率是很低的，如果把环境成本算进去，其实利润率更低。那么到底怎么样来 解决这个问题，是纯粹靠市场力量，还是靠一些行政命令？
第一，对 国有企业的监管将来将通过吸收民间资本的进入，形成一个产权多元化的股份制的公司。那么在产权多元化的基础上呢，有股东啊对企业的经营活动进行严格的监管，因为他们最关心自己投到这个公司的钱能不能够取得更多的回报。
Okay, I'll take your first question first. In terms of the state-owned enterprises, the oversight will be mainly conducted by absorbing private capital into state-owned enterprises so as to form a shareholding company with diverse property rights. And on that basis, shareholders will strictly oversee the performances and operations of the company because shareholders care a lot about the returns of their investment.
如果国有企业只有单一的一个政府啊，这个股东是难以进行有效监管的。如果这个股东里边又有民营企业，又有外资企业，啊，这就能够对国有企业的经营进行有效的监管。
There will be no effective oversight and regulation upon state-owned enterprises if the government is the only shareholder. If we let the private capital and the foreign capital into the game, there will be an effective oversight over the state-owned enterprises.
我举个例子，比如说最近我们在福建的湄洲湾新建了一个大型的石油炼化企业，1000万吨炼油，300万吨一吸，股东有四个，第一是美国的 Action 公司，第二是沙特一个石油公司，第三个是由我们中石化公司，第四个是由福建的一家地方的国有公司。
I'll give you one example. Lately, we have built a massive petroleum refinery in the Meizhou Bay in Fujian province. It is enormous in size, and there are four different ownerships in this company. The first shareholder is the Exxon company in the United States. The second is a Saudi Arabian oil company. The third is the Sinopec, and the fourth is a local oil industry in the Fujian province.
那么埃克森公司有技术，沙特这个公司有原油，中石化呢有市场，福建这个公司呢有地皮，那么这四家公司组织在一起就是一个非常完美的组合，那么为它将来发展和竞争力的提高提供了一个很好的基础。
This U.S. company has technology, the Saudi Arabian company has the oil, Sinopec has the market, and the local company in Fujian has land. So this is a very perfect combination, and this forms a solid foundation for its future development and its competitiveness.
Thank you.
第二个是关于这个钢铁产业。
现在消化过剩的产能是中国面临的最大的难题，因为整个工业生产能力已经全面过剩。
Now, digesting the excessive production capacity is the biggest conundrum faced by China right now because it is a common problem in almost all industrial sectors.
那么第一呢，我们还是希望通过扩大内需来使一部分产能能够发挥出来。
Firstly, we are hoping that through expanding domestic demand, we will digest a part of the excessive capacity.
第二个呢，就是向海外投资能够转移出去一部分。
Secondly, we are hoping to transfer some of this capacity by outbound investment.
第三呢，想通过它的重组来消化一部分。
And third is by reorganizing the industry so as to digest a part of the capacity.
第四呢，就是 毫不留情的淘汰一部分。你们看看最近这个河北省啊，报道到处都在炸掉那些落后的小钢厂。
And the last way is that we will ruthlessly take out some of the enterprises to take them out of the game. For lately, we have blown up some backward, small-scaled steel firms in the Hebei province.
Thank you.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Jennifer, correspondent for China Shenzhen Media Group. And my question is going to be, as some Western media said, China's leaders are doing a lot more talking about reform than real reforming. But we all know they are dangerous in pressing forward too rapidly in economic reform. So what's your take on the speed of economic reform in China? Thank you so much.
The speed of the 中国媒体和外媒对于中国进行这个经济改革的速度都有很大的关注，观点也不是很一致。他想问您对中国经济改革速度这样的看法。
三中全会决定已经把2020年作为完成这些改革任务的最后期限。
The deadline for the reform to be implemented is the year 2020. It is set.
在7年10年内能不能够完成这300多项改革任务确实非常艰巨。我们国内的老百姓跟国外的媒体一样啊，好多人也是担心完不成这个任务。
There is undoubtedly this is a huge challenge to finish all these over 300 different reforms within 7 years, and the Chinese people and overseas media are very concerned about this the speed of the reform.
但是要相信我们十八大选出的新的领导他们的决心和魄力。
However, we have to be confident of the determination and the resolution of the new leadership elected through the 18th National Conference of the CPC.
中央改革领导小组已经成立，刚刚成立就开了两次会。
Shortly after the leading group of the comprehensively deepening reform was established, there have been 2 meetings.
习近平总书记亲自来当这个组长，另外还有3个常委当副组长，我们有7个常委，4个常委都参与到这个领导小组中间来。
President Xi Jinping himself presides over the leading group. There are other 3 members of the standing committee, which are the vice heads of the leading group. So 4 of the 7 members of the standing committee are involved in this plan.
另外，他的办公室就设在我原来退休之前的那个工作单位——中央政策研究室，非常荣幸。
And I am honored to tell you that the office of the leading group was set in the Central Committee Policy Planning, Policy Research Office, where I used to work before I retired.
另外，六大改革分别成立了6个小组。
And under this leading group, there are 6 subgroups applied to 6 different areas of reform.
这六个小组里边，大部分都是由政治局委员来负责。
And the majority of the subgroups are overseen by members of the Politburo.
还有一条啊，就是我们习近平总书记啊，他的作风是非常认真果断的。
And there's another reason for our confidence is that it is that the President Xi Jinping's style is he is a very conscientious and he is very resolute.
他现在经常说的一句话就叫抓铁有痕，踏实留印。
Lately, he has been using a very vivid phrase. That is, when we grab an iron, there has to be marks left on the iron, and when we step on snow, when we stepped on stones, there have to be footprints on the stones.
他还说要发扬钉钉子的精神。
And also he talks about a very conscientious implementation of these reforms. It's like pegging a nail into the wall.
他还说, 干部要用 90% 的精力来抓落实。
He also demands that the government officials should devote 90% of their time and energy into implementation.
中国老百姓的感觉跟国外媒体的感觉一样，因为中央的决心已经明确了，都写在这个决定里了。那么广大企业和老百姓呢，看了以后啊，也是跃跃欲试，啊，心的热乎乎的。最担心的就是，啊，我们的政府的部门啊和地方政府在改革中间不积极，延误时间。
Now, the Chinese people feel the same way as the foreign media. The central government has been very clear in terms of their determination and resolution in this new round of reform, while the enterprises and the common people are itching to plunge into this new round of reform. But what we are very concerned about is that there probably will be some obstruction from the government departments and local governments. So they probably will not be so anxious to promote reform, and probably they will stall the reform.
但是你们相信呢，这次改革是中央党中央在抓啊，党中央是管人事的，管干部任命的，也就是说，不换思想就换人。
However, we must be rest assured that this new round of reform is overseen by the central government and the party central committee, who are not only in charge of specific matters, but also personnel movement. So if we don't change what we think, we'll change jobs.
那些拖延改革甚至反对改革的人，我看会要靠边站。
And from my personal observance, I think those who stand against the reforms will step aside and should step aside.
会挑选那些容易改革的干部啊，到领导岗位上来。
And we will select those who are bold to embrace the reforms into the leadership.
Thank you.
Stanley Kober. You have mentioned the growing number of international patents. Patents have to be protected by law. The United States complains that China does not protect intellectual property rights sufficiently. And I would invite your reaction to those complaints. As your innovation grows, how will your attitude toward the rule of law and intellectual property change?
您刚才说到了这个中国的这个专利申请量的发展，那么美国有一些抱怨，就是说中国对于知识产权的保护并不是十分有力。所以我的问题就是，您对这样的一种抱怨是如何回应的？随着中国不断的进行创新，如何能保证以依法的方式来进行这个知识产权的保护？首先，我说美国的抱怨。
可能比起我们中国的企业和中国的科技专利的发明者来比啊，他们的抱怨比美国的同行的抱怨更为强烈。
First, I must say that probably the complaints from the Chinese enterprises and the inventors of these patents are louder than the complaints of their U.S. counterparts.
我先生长期研究中国技术进步问题，我们的软件始终没有发展起来，远远落后于印度。 那么，一个最重要的原因就是我们对软件的保护不力，对软件的知识产权不尊重。
I personally have been dedicated to the research of China's technology progress, and I have to say that China's software industry is very backward, even more underdeveloped than that of India. And I think the most important reason is that China's IPR protection and China's protection of the software industry is very weak.
我知道美国的专利法是林肯总统制定的，第一个专利证书是林肯总统亲自颁发的。
As far as I'm concerned, the United States patent law was established by President Lincoln, and the first certificate was also given by this president.
所以之后才出现了像贝尔实验室这样一些大量的专利的创造者。
It was only after that we have witnessed a surge in the patent applications, and there have been a lot of prestigious patents like the Bell Laboratory, etc.
知识产权的创造才进入了良性循环。
And the IPR protection and the IPR has entered into a very very positive cycle.
中国的知识产权的立法。 也正在完善，三中全会决定特意把知识、同技术、劳动、资本等要素放在一起，列入参与分配的要素的行列之内，体现了对知识的尊重。
Now China is in the process of improving IPR legislation, and in the document adopted by the third plenary session, the knowledge has been put at the same level as technology, labor, and capital, and these three factors will take part in the distribution on an equal footing.
我们欢迎美国的同行和朋友到中国去。 帮助我们一起把中国的知识产权的保护的这个环境能够搞得更好。
We are most welcome to improving our IPR. We are most welcome to improving IPR climate in China with the help of our U.S. counterparts and friends.
Thank you.
Thank you. Dana Marshall with Transnational Strategy Group. Thank you, Mr. Zheng, for those comments. You've emphasized throughout your remarks the importance of the reform program of the last plenum, et cetera. And you also mentioned, kind of in a joking way, but since you got a little bit into specific sectors about the high-speed rail, I wonder if you could, if I could focus your attention, maybe get some thoughts from you about what does the reform program, what could it mean for helping to balance the enormous trade deficit the United States still has with China, about $300 billion? What sectors do you think could be fruitful ones for the United States to look at? Is there a renewed emphasis that we can expect for an emphasis on consumption rather than exports, something that for the last at least 15 years, administrations of the United States have been discussing with China? How do you see this going? Will we start seeing some real movement? Because I think it's obvious that these enormous trade deficits are unsustainable. Thank you.
他想问的问题是关于中国这个美中的巨大的贸易赤字，现在是2000亿美元的规模，这当然是不可持续的。那么美国政府过去15年来一直在强调，要扩大美对中的这个出口以及扩大这个消费。那他想问的是，中国政府会采取一些切实的行动来改变目前的巨额的贸易逆差？
中美贸易逆差今后我觉得会逐渐的缩小，这个问题大家可能逐渐不会把它作为一个什么问题了。From
my perspective, the enormous trade deficit that we are seeing right now will be gradually reduced, and in the near future, it won't create such a fuss.
第一，我看到。 克林顿总统，奥巴马总统提出，<笑>就是 出口倍增计划。
等一下。
那么这个出口倍增计划呢，那么把美国出口的高技术产品的过去列入限制出口的现在已经解禁了30%，这对美国扩大对中国的出口是有利的。
I have seen that President Obama has issued a plan to amplify, to multiply U.S. export, and 30% of high-tech products, which in the past have been restricted to be exported, have been relaxed. Their limits have been relaxed, and I think it will do much help to enlarge the U.S. export to China.
第二。奥巴马总统提出了一个再工业的计划，那么美国将会在国内增加技术装备啊和先进制造业产品的生产，那么这些产品呢，将来对中国的出口会增加，因为中国的产业升级对这些产品呢将会提出更多的需求。
And the second good news, the second piece of good news is that also a plan issued by President Obama that is reindustrialization. The United States will devote a lot of its energy into production of technology, technological equipments and advanced manufacturing, which means further expansion of U.S. export to China because China needs this kind of high-tech, very advanced manufacturing products due to our economic upgrading.
特别是美国政府实行了一些吸引在国外投资的企业回归美国的一些政策措施。那么过去呢，中国对美国的出口30%+呢，都是由美国的企业在中国设立的加工贸易企业生产的产品返销到国内的。那么随着这些企业呢回到美国国内来生产，那么这部分加工贸易的这个中国对美国的出口啊将会下降。
And I have taken notice that the United States government have been trying to bring back American companies that are operating overseas back into America. And actually in the past, 30% of China's exports to the United States were manufactured by United States companies that have invested in China in the processing trade. And these products are sold back to the U.S. mainland. And through this new reform in the United States, I think the export from China to the United States will fall.
第三，原来中国对美国出口的一些劳动密集型、资源密集型产品，那么随着我们国内的劳动成本在增加，劳动力成本在增加，资源呢越来越短缺，那么这些出口现在我觉得已经到了顶点了，到了天花板了，以后呢会随着这些劳动密集型产品呢向东南亚国家转移所以这部分出口不但不会增加，甚至还会减少。
Thirdly, a major part of the China's exports to the United States are those labor and resource-intensive products. As the labor costs in China are spiking, as we are in great shortage of natural resources, I think that our export in these labor and resource-intensive products have reached the ceiling. And in the future, we will transfer these industries into countries in the, for example, in Southeast Asia. So I think this is also contributive to the fall of the trade deficit.
第四，随着双边投资的增加，美国对中国的农产品和畜产品的出口将会增加。比如说，最近我们双汇，那么收购了美国的 一家全世界最大的生猪饲养公司。过去这个公司呢，这个猪肉想卖到中国市场，遇到这样那样的障碍。那么现在变成中国的双汇公司的一个全资的子公司了，那么这些猪肉呢，向中国出口会更方便了。另外，中国对啊大豆啊、饲料啊等这些进口量将来会啊不断的增加啊，所以美国的农产品和畜产品对中国出口的前景非常广阔，所以这四个原因加在一起呢，啊，中美贸易的啊这个顺差呀 啊逐渐可能就没有了。
Fourthly, the U.S. exports to China will mainly rise in the agricultural products and the animal husbandry products. Recently, China's meat factory, Shuanghui, has purchased a very famous company in the United States. And in the past, this company encountered a lot of difficulties in exporting pork to the Chinese market. But now this company is a subsidiary of the Chinese company Shuanghui, so there is greater convenience in pork export. Also, China has huge demand for the import of beans and animal grains, for example. So I'm trying to say that the U.S. agricultural and animal husbandry products will be exported to China in larger shares. And I think in the future, based on the above mentioned four reasons, the trade deficit is expected to be lower.
Thank you.
Got one in the back here. In the back.
Thank you again for this fascinating presentation. David Sedney, self-employed consultant. Last fall, Larry Summers and Lant Pritchett from Harvard issued a warning about a possible downturn in the Chinese and Indian economies and recommended that Western policymakers take mitigating steps to prepare for such an event. I was wondering, in the Third Plenum, was there any similar attempts to look at some kind of hedging strategies toward on the growth that you predict, such as expanding social safety nets or other measures to, if, in case of such a downturn, or if that's something that you dismiss? Thank you.
Excuse me, he's talking about social
safety nets. So he's saying that in the event of an unexpected downturn, mm-hmm. are there policies related to expanding the social safety net or something mm-hmm. along those lines to take that into account? Mm-hmm.
关于中国，他问的这个问题是关于中国社会保障系统的，因为他在有一些讨论，就是说这个中国的社会保障可能会保障网可能经历一些低谷吧，所以他想问这个三中全会决定对于加强建设社会保障这一块有什么具体的一些想法。
完善社会保障体系是这一次决定关于社会体制改革的一个最重要的内容。
To improve the social safety, the social security system is one of the most important parts of this reform.
我们将尽快建立覆盖13亿人口的养老保险和医疗保险。
We will establish a old age caring system and a medical care system that will cover 1.3 billion Chinese people as soon as possible.
而且尽快实现城乡养老保险的一体化和基础养老金的全国统筹。
Meanwhile, we will try to integrate the old age caring system between urban and rural areas and to lay out an overall planning of the old age pension system.
我们将实行低水平广覆盖这样一个原则，使这个保障水平啊能够同我们经济发展的水平相适应。
We will try to implement these social safety systems on the principle of low level but extensive coverage so as to match this social safety net with the economic growth currently in China.
在这方面，我们将接受总结美国和欧洲的经验和教训。
So in terms of our future endeavor, we will learn from the experiences and to draw on the experience as maybe some lessons of the United States and Europe.
欧洲的保险成为财政的一个沉重的包袱，现在已经陷入政府债务的危机了。
One of the reasons why the European countries fell into the debt crisis is because of this large social safety provision.
我们这个保障水平一定要把它控制在财力可以承受的范围之内。
So we have to rein in our own social safety services, safety networks within the limit of our fiscal capabilities.
我们的医疗保险呢，将会吸取美国的一些教训。Also,
we will learn from the past mistakes or some past mistakes of the United States in terms of our medical care system.
尽管我们现在人均 GDP 只有6000美元，美国人均 GDP 已经达到50000美元了。
但是我们的医疗保险覆盖面已经达到98%，美国的医疗保险只有80%。在这个问题上，我跟一些美国的经济学家朋友在一起谈的时候，他们说：“哎呀，我们太不好意思了。”Although China's per capita GDP is only $6,000. This number in the United States is 50,000. However, the coverage of medical care system in China is 98%, while it's only a little more than 80% in the United States. So some U.S. Friends, when they are talking to me, say that they are quite embarrassed.
我们祝愿奥巴马总统的医疗改革方案能够顺利成功。
So I hope President Obama's medical care program will be, healthcare program will be a success.
Put the friend
here. Yeah.
Wait for the microphone.
My name is Pat Malloy. I'm a Washington trade lawyer. You mentioned that China has about $3.8 trillion worth of foreign currency reserves. I think the United States has run about $3 trillion worth of trade deficits with China since China joined the WTO, so that accounts for a lot of the foreign currency reserves. You indicated that China would do a lot more investing in the United States. I note that a lot of the Chinese investment, probably about 85% of it, is coming from state-owned enterprises controlled by the party. Americans traditionally have not wanted our own government owning major chunks of our economy, for example, you saw the backlash against the government owning part of General Motors in this country. If we're going to be taking that Chinese investment to help us improve our rails, as you talked about, does that mean that we have to be more accepting the fact that portions of our economy will be owned by the Chinese government and the Chinese Communist Party?
他是一个来自华盛顿的贸易方面的律师。您刚才说到，中国目前有 3.8万亿的外汇储备，而从美国，从中国加入世贸组织以来，美国对中国的贸易逆差达到了3万亿美元，所以这对于中国巨大的外汇储备可能是一个原因之一。那么您刚才说到中国会增加对美国的投资，但是我知道呢，80%的中国对美国的投资都是来自于中国的国有企业，这是中国共产党控制的这个。 国有企业，那么您刚才说到，比如说中国要投资美国的高铁，如果我们接受这样一部分中国投资，是否意味着我们接受了中国政府和共产党控制了美国的部分的经济？这个说法呢，是因为对中国的资本结构还不够了解。 I think that the part of the reason you have this question is because you do not understand very well about China's capital structure.
中国的民营经济现在已经占到我们GDP的70%， 国有企业占了只有30%。
Private or non-government capital takes up around 70% of our GDP, while SOEs take up only 30%.
现在绝大部分的到海外的投资都是由民营企业实现的。
The majority of China's overseas investment is done by private capital.
包括国有企业，绝大部分都已经在海外上市， 而且主要集中在纽约的股票市场上市。
Even in terms of the state-owned enterprises, a majority of SOEs have been listed in foreign stock exchanges, for example, the New York Stock Exchange.
所以 80% to 90% 的国有企业都拥有美国股民的股份，美国的股民实际上已经成为我们绝大部分国有企业的股东。
80% to 90% of China's SOEs have their shares held by United States shareholders. So I'm trying to say that probably the United States shareholders, the United States citizens are the shareholders of these state-owned enterprises of China.
所以他们到美国投资，等于是美国的股民自己在自己的国土上投资。
So if these SOEs invest in the United States, practically it is the United States shareholders investing in their own country.
Matt Goodman.
Thank you. Matthew Goodman from here at CSIS. Last September, China opened a pilot free trade zone in Shanghai. Could you explain how this fits into the national plan for reform and specifically which aspects of the Shanghai FTZ reforms are of most interest to the national government in Beijing?
与这个三中全会的整个的改革计划有什么样的关系，它如何能够融入到新一轮的改革计划之中，并且这个上海自贸区有哪些具体的内容，与这个改革是有关系的，或者是有促进的。提出建立自由贸易园区和自由贸易港区是三中全会在对外决定方面的一个重大的改革措施。
A very important and very significant reform that has been put forward by the third plenary session in its document is to speed up the building of free trade zones and free trade ports.
这也是学习了美国的经验。
This is also an experience learned from the United States.
美国有200多个自由贸易园区，都办得很好。
The United States is home to over 200 free trade zones or parks, and they are all doing very well.
我们实行的自由贸易园区，包括上海的自由贸易园区，它的最大的特点就是实行境内关外的政策。在自由贸易园区之内，商品、货物、货币、人员可以自由往来。 自由交易。
Now, one of the most significant hallmarks of the FTZ is that commodities, goods, currencies, and staff, people can flow freely within the free trade zone.
除了上海之外呢，我们还准备在舟山群岛，1000多个岛子，1000多平方公里。 将来逐步呢，全部都要成为自由贸易港区。
Apart from Shanghai Free Trade Zone, we're planning to build free trade ports on the Zhoushan archipelago, there are over 1,000 small islands in this area, taking up to around 1,000 square kilometers of land, and we will build all these islands into free trade ports.
自由港区将分三步走，第一步先办好综合保税区，第二步办好自由贸易园区，第三步学习借鉴香港和新加坡的经验，办一个自由港区，这样就可以实现邓小平先生所设想的再造几个香港的这个设想。
We will take a three-step strategy to build the Zhoushan free trade ports. The first step is to build a comprehensive bonding area. The second step is to build FTZ. And thirdly, we will draw on the experiences of Hong Kong and Singapore to build these free trade zones into free trade ports so as to realize what Mr. Deng Xiaoping has envisioned, which is to build a couple of more Hong Kongs.
我们欢迎美国的企业，包括你们的金融类的企业，到我们的自由贸易园区和自由港域区去投资，从而抢占先机。
And we advise that the U.S. enterprises should go to should invest in these free trade zones and free trade ports so as to take the lead in the new opportunities presenting ahead.
Time for one more question, right here, on the left.
Thank you, Leah from Voice of America. You mentioned the, one of the reform measures is to have the liberalization of the capital account and also the internationalization of the currency. I'm just wondering if you can talk about a little bit the thinking behind the recent depreciation of the Chinese currency, and also what kind of timetable does China have for the liberalization of the capital account and the internationalization of the currency?
您刚才提到了人民币资本项目可兑换以及人民币国际化的问题，我想问您的是，您对最近这个
人民币对美元贬值这个情况有什么样的看法？同时呢，在人民币自由化和资本项目可兑换的问题上，中国有没有一个时间表？人民币在资本项目上可兑换，以及成为国际货币，是我们改革的目标。
One of our reform targets is to realize the convertibility of RMB under capital accounts and for RMB to go global.
那么最近出现的人民币汇率的对美元有所下降，这是一个正常的、暂时的一个波动。
And depreciation recently for RMB to US dollar, I think, is a very normal but a very temporary phenomenon. It's a temporary volatility.
从长远来看，人民币对美元将会处在一个不断升值的这样一个过程，因为人民币从购买力评价来看。 大概多数机构计算的结果呢，大概是和3元人民币左右能够换1，相当于1美元。
Over the long haul, I think the general trend is that the value of RMB to US dollar will rise because in terms of PPP, according to calculations, this ratio should be 3 RMB to $1.
那么购买力评价的这个人民币对美元的汇率呢？它表现出来的是人民币的实际的购买力，也就是说它的使用价值。那么将来随着中国的产品出口竞争力的提高，那么从现在它这个按实际购买力的这个评价向未来的 有市场汇率啊，现在的市场汇率向它的实际购买力来接近。 这是一个长期的发展的一个历史过程。
As we know, the PPP reflects the real purchasing power, and as China's as the export competitiveness of Chinese goods is expected to rise in the future, it's only a matter of time before the market currency exchange rate matches the real PPP value.
当中国的出口结构有现在的以 劳动密集型、资源密集型产品为主，逐步的转变到以技术密集型、资本密集型和知识密集型产品为主的时候呢，那么人民币啊，它的汇率可能会逐步的跟它的实际的购买力会接近。
There will be a change, as I have mentioned, in China's export mix. Right now, we are focusing on labor and resource-intensive products, but it will be gradually changed into exporting capital, technology, and knowledge-intensive products, which means that the currency exchange rate will match the real purchasing power.
中国现在逐步的放宽人民币浮动的这个幅度，那么使它在市场波动中间逐步的向它的实际的汇率来靠近。
Right now, China is expanding the spectrum of the RMB floating spectrum so as to match its currency exchange rate to the real purchasing power.
为了防止大量的热钱融入，最近我们也在研究，采用通行的办法，比如说征收脱冰税，来解决热钱的流入流出的问题，来避免带来中国经济的波动。脱冰税。 就是对热钱的流入流出，征收一定的税，叫脱冰税。
In order to prevent hot money, the hot money influx to China, we are actually taking some universal practice in this area, like imposing taxation on the hot money influx, so as to steer China away from being the victim of the hot money.
比如说，对流进来的资金征1%的税，流出去的资金征1%的税。 那么他是长期投资呢，5年、10年的投资，他就不在乎这点税。如果当年流入，当年有流出，他对这点税都很在乎。这样呢，我就可以避免呢短期的热钱的流入流出，对经济产生冲击，鼓励长期投资的进入。
For example, if we impose 1% of tax to the money coming in and out of China, the businesses which are aiming at long-term practice operation in China won't care such a small minimum of tax. But those short-term hot money will care a lot about the 1% tax. So by so doing, we are encouraging long-term investment and avoiding short-term blow to the Chinese financial stability.
当然，这是我们智库的一些经济学家的建议，它还没有变成国家的政策。
But it is only an advice of the think tank, the economists of the think tank. It has not yet been adopted as a national decision.
Thank you.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Mr. Zheng. I really appreciate your frankness and the comprehensiveness of your comments. Please join me in thanking him and our interpreter. Thank you.
Oh.